want to talk a little bit about the possible future for the use of psychedelic drugs in psychiatry. The history of the use of psychedelics in Western medicine is pretty short, and it was also pretty disastrous. It started in 1943 when the properties of LSD, lysergic acid, were discovered by Albert Hofmann, who worked for the Sandoz drug company in Switzerland. He was investigating the effects of plant extracts called ergots, and he synthesized this compound, which he managed to get onto his fingers during the process of synthesis. And he noticed strange subjective sensations, and he was smart enough to realize that this was pretty unusual, and he was curious about what it was. So what he did was he got a synthesis of this compound, and he deliberately administered 250 micrograms to himself. So he was the first person in Western society to take LSD as pure LSD. And he then attempted to cycle home to his house for lunch. And it was an interesting ride. It's sometimes called the bicycle day. And on that day, he experienced all the extraordinary visual and subjective sensations associated with an LSD trip, as it came to be called. He was immediately amazed by the implications of this. And others who read about it were also incredibly interested by what he discovered. Because what he was showing was that you could profoundly change perception and the mind with a dose of a drug in the microgram range. And prior to this, drugs that acted on the brain had really been thought of as depressants, drugs that essentially would be present in milligram amounts at least, and their mechanism of action was not at all well understood. And in fact, at the time, we didn't really understand that brain cells communicate with each other through chemistry. So this was a finding that was way ahead of its time in some ways. And it gave a major stimulus to basic neuroscience. So people then went on to discover the compounds that we now call monoamines, which are analogous to LSD. LSD works on the receptors that are naturally occurring for these receptors, but for these not neurotransmitters, particularly serotonin. And in addition, there was an interest for clinical application. So this is, we're talking about 1947, as early as that. Sandoz made LSD available for psychiatrists to use in psychiatric patients. And in those days, there was very little regulation, so doctors were pretty free to try things out and report back. And in fact, they did that on a very remarkable scale in the 1950s. It was mainly with LSD, but other drugs then came along, and it was realized that, of course, there was a big tradition in the use of these sorts of drugs, its plant extracts, in a number of indigenous societies across the world, but particularly in South America. And that led to the discovery of other drugs like mescaline, which comes from the peyote cactus, and also of psilocybin from mushrooms, magic mushrooms, as they're sometimes called. And magic mushrooms grow all over temperate climates, for example, in Europe. So they're present, they're with us all the time. Now these compounds all have in common that they bind to this group of receptors called the 5-HT2A receptors in the brain. And therefore they work on serotonin pathways. And this was established relatively recently, but nevertheless it was the stimulus to basic neuroscience that got us going initially. What happened to the clinical application if it was so widespread? About 40,000 patients were probably treated, and it was regarded as a way of facilitating psychotherapy at the time. And the problem was that this was before the time when psychiatrists really thought carefully about the objective properties of the illnesses that they were looking at. This didn't start until the 1980s. So the psychiatrists used very vague descriptions, and they used, in order to understand the effects, the terms that derive from psychoanalysis, which we now find a little confusing and ambiguous. So that for us is a limitation of what is actually happening in the 1950s and reading the literature of the time. Now, if we had simply continued to use the drug, there would have been the possibility to understand better which patients it was best for, how good it was for them, what the long-term outcomes were. But unfortunately, other things happened. And the other thing that happened was the widespread use, particularly of LSD, but also these other drugs, in what was called the counterculture in the United States in the 1960s. And that resulted in a kind of moral panic around the use of these drugs by young people, the fact that this was resulting in a tremendous social schism, and it also fed very much into issues around the Vietnam War. The Vietnam War was tremendously divisive in the United States. It pitted the younger generation against older people, and the use of drugs became a symbolic way of, in a sense, rubbing in the difference, and it became a political worry. And so the politicians, as they usually do, resort to law to try and prevent things, and they made the drugs illegal. And when the United States makes drugs illegal, other countries, basically through treaties, usually have to follow suit. And that's effectively what happened. So that in 1970, LSD and similar compounds were classified as highly dangerous drugs that were illegal. And an illegal drug is something that a person can use illegally, but it's not something a doctor can use legally, by definition. So doctors, researchers, could really no longer use the drug for human experimentation or human treatment studies. And so, essentially, the whole thing went underground. People in America continued to use these drugs to assist psychotherapy, but it was essentially outside the law, it was outside formal reporting procedures, it was unregistered. So in a sense, we lost these important compounds for many, many years, and we, two generations kills interest in anything. So that was the position we were in the 2000s, and the noughties, as we call them, in the year 2000s. At about that time, people started to get interested again. And what has happened in the last 10 years is that people have applied to do clinical research studies, scientific studies on these drugs under control conditions using modern measurements. And we've started to try and rediscover them and also rediscover their potential uses. And to cut a very long story short, there have now been at least two trials which have been reasonably well controlled. So there's been a kind of placebo condition which allows you to say what the effects of the active treatment is versus no treatment or minimal treatment. And what seems to occur is that in patients, particularly with depressive symptoms, that there is a good long-term outcome over many months of treatment with a single dose of particularly psilocybin. And psilocybin is emerging as probably the hallucinogen of choice because it's a probably gentler experience than LSD. It doesn't last as long, so it fits into the working day. And it's now relatively easy to synthesize, so it's available. You don't have to get it from a mushroom, you can get it in a pure form. And of course, the great risk with illegal drugs is you actually don't know what you're taking. So what we're moving to is an era in which we will look much more carefully about what psilocybin, probably first, what its properties are for treating patients with particularly mood disorders. Now, the interesting part of this story is that the initial studies were done in people who were depressed or anxious because they had terminal cancer. And the idea was that their existential distress about their life soon ending would be the thing that was influenced by the drug. So the drug would give you this mystical experience. That mystical experience would make you reevaluate your life, your death, and in a sense make it more bearable. And that's pretty much what people describe, but it's also very much what people expected. What was a little less predictable was that people, depressive symptoms were so clearly treated. And so what has now happened is that we've gone on to look in patients with treatment-resistant depression who don't have an existential crisis, so they're not in a position where their life is going to end, but they are often in a position where their life has become totally miserable and worthless. And the question is then, does this drug re-establish some kind of function? And in the first 20 patients that were treated in London at Imperial College, there was a surprisingly good response. And in some of those patients, a transformational response when taking a full dose of psilocybin and then following up for at least a year. And I met three of those patients, the three who probably had the best responses. And it's most impressive to talk to them. They have very long and complicated histories. They had got to the end of the line. They were really contemplating suicide. They thought their lives were really worthless. And they have been turned around by the experience with this drug. Now, that's not game, set, and match for any compound. You have to do fair comparisons between an active treatment and perhaps the treatment, the standard treatment, or no treatment at all. And those studies are now starting to be done. But we seem to be on the verge of a new era in which we take these important drugs seriously, we use them under clinical settings, and we may be able to remedicalize them. The big risk we face is whether, in remedicalizing them, we reintroduce them into free range, where people use them for recreational purposes. And the difficulty with that is that these drugs are dangerous when people take them in the wrong setting, with the wrong people, the wrong circumstances, and really, really bad things can happen. And that was part of the original moral panic, as well as the political implications of drug use. And it remains a valid concern, which we've got to take very seriously. So the challenge for our societies is, are we going to simply re-establish these drugs for medical indications? And if we are going to do that, what are we going to do about recreational indications? Because all the experience of cannabis suggests that you start with a medical indication, but you end up with a much wider recreational legality, which is happening all over North America, and we're not sure is really a great idea for society at large. So that's where we sit at the moment. We sit at an interesting point. We await the results of definitive trials to show the usefulness of psilocybin and other hallucinogens, particularly in depression and difficult to treat depression. But we're unsure how we're going to take this forward, maintaining a medical cocoon of safety, while at the same time recognizing that people may claim the right to make these drugs a recreational choice. And it's going to be an interesting social and political challenge to get this right.